Hello and welcome, dear students. Today we are going to discuss an important topic, that is role of enzymes in food processing. The main objectives of today's lecture are to give a brief introduction about enzymes, to discuss in detail enzymes for fruit juice processing, to discuss enzymes for dairy and baking processing, to discuss enzymes for processing of other food products. Dear students, let us first of all discuss enzymes. Enzymes are biological catalysts that promote most of the biochemical reactions which occur in the cell. As is typical for catalysts, they speed up biochemical reactions without being consumed in the process. Depending on the type of reaction catalyzed, enzymes are divided into six main classes: oxidoreductases, transferases, hydrolases, lyases, isomerases, and ligases. The presence of enzymes in food is very common, with oxidoreductases and hydrolases being the most important ones. In the oxidoreductase group, the enzymes that are of interest for the food industry are phenolases, catalases, peroxidases, and lipoxygenases. The importance of enzymes is likely to increase as consumers demand more natural products free of chemical additives. Enzymes extracted from edible plants and the tissues of food animals, as well as those produced by microorganisms, have been used for centuries in food manufacturing. Alternatively, for centuries, enzymes produced by yeast have been used to ferment grape juice in order to make wine. At present, enzymes are used in bakery, brewing, dairy, meat, sugar, fruit processing, and other food industries. Various enzymes used are amylases, proteases, lipases, glycoxidases, pectinases, and tinases, and many others. Enzymes produced through biotechnology are identical to those found in nature. The worldwide application of these will increase by developing tailor-made enzymes through recombinant DNA technology. Which could enhance the yields and modify their specificity to meet consumers' requirement in terms of cost, calorie, and taste. Dear students, now moving on to another objective, that is role of enzyme in fruit juice processing. The demand of fruit juices is increasing day by day as a result of increasing health awareness among the people. Enzymatic extraction of juices results in higher yield. Enzymes can play important roles in preparing and processing various fruit and vegetable juices, such as apple, orange, grapefruit, cranberry, pineapple, grape, carrot, and lemon. Fruits and vegetables are particularly rich in pectic substances. Pectic, a hydrocolloid, has a great affinity for water and can form gels under certain conditions. The addition of exogenous enzymes such as pectinases, pectin lyase, and polygalactourinase reduces viscosity and improves pressibility as well as the pectic gel collapses. For complete liquefaction of fruits and vegetables, hemicelluloses, cellulases, and amylases can be used in addition to pectinases. Various commercial enzyme preparations are currently available for such use in the fruit juice industry. Enzymatic debittering of grapefruit juice can be achieved through the application of fungal naringenase preparations. naringenin is reported to provide antioxidant and other beneficial effects to human health. Another enzyme, the flavoprotein glucose oxidase, is used to scavenge oxygen in fruit juice and beverages to prevent color and taste changes upon storage. Dear students, moving on to the next part, that is role of enzymes in dairy processing. Lactic acid bacteria have a complex proteolytic system capable of converting milk casein to the free amino acids and peptides necessary for their growth. These proteinases include extracellular proteinases, endopeptidases, aminopeptidases, tripeptidases, and proline-specific peptides, which are all serine proteases. Aminopeptidases are important for the development of flavor in fermented milk products, since they are capable of releasing single amino acid residues from oligopeptides formed by extracellular proteinase activity. Rennets. Rennin, a mixture of chymosin and pepsin, obtained mainly from animal and microbial sources, are used for coagulation of milk in the first stage of cheese production. Other enzymes used for dairy food application include proteases to reduce allergic properties of cow milk products for infants, lipases for development of lipolytic flavors in specialty cheeses. The functional properties of milk proteins may be improved by limited proteolysis through the enzymatic modification of milk proteins. An acid-soluble casein, free of flavor and suitable for incorporation into beverages and other acid foods, has been prepared by limited proteolysis. The antigenicity of casein is destroyed by proteolysis, and the hydrolysate is suitable for use in milk protein-based foods for infants allergic to cow milk. Dear students, moving on to next part, that is role of enzymes in baking processing. For decades, enzymes such as malt and fungal alpha amylases have been used in bread making. Rapid advances in biotechnology have made a number of exciting new enzymes available for the baking industry. The dough for bread, rolls, buns, and similar products consists of flour, water, yeast, salt, and possible other ingredients such as sugar and fat. Flour consists of gluten, starch, non-starch polysaccharides, lipids, and trace amounts of minerals. As soon as the dough is made, the yeast starts to work on the fermentable sugars, transforming them into alcohol and carbon dioxide, which makes the dough rise. The main component of wheat flour is starch. Amylases can degrade starch and produce small dextrins for the yeast to act upon. Enzymes such as hemicellulases, xylanases, lipases, and oxidases can directly or indirectly improve the strength of the gluten network and so improve the quality of the finished bread. Dear students, now we will discuss other roles of enzymes in food processing. Here, first of all, we discuss enzymes in the modification of fats and oils. Lipases are a ubiquitous class of enzymes which catalyze hydrolysis, esterification, and transesterification. These enzymes are involved in fat hydrolysis, flavor development in dairy products, transesterification of fats and oils, and production of chiral organic compounds. There are two broad types of lipases based on their positional specificity. Number one is non-specific lipase, releases fatty acids from all three positions of the glycerol moiety and is used to hydrolyze fats and oils completely to free fatty acids and glycerol. Number 2, the other type of enzyme is 1,3 specific lipase, which releases fatty acids from 1,3 positions and preferentially free fatty acids and di- and monoglycerides as the reaction products. Lipases can be used to hydrolyze fats and oils with excellent yields. Similarly, lipase catalyzes transesterification of plant glycerides to make alkyl esters for use as biodiesel and replace base catalyzed processes would be a huge market for enzyme biotechnology. Enrichment of oils with highly unsaturated fatty acids can be made by lipase-mediated transesterification reactions to produce nutraceuticals. Lipases are also used to assist in the extraction of fats and oils and for the development of cheese flavor. Dear students, now we will discuss enzymes in the fish and meat processing. Proteinases, either indigenous or those obtained from plants and microorganisms, are used in the meat and fish industries to tenderize meat and solubilize fish products. Plant proteinases include papain from papaya, ficin from figs, and bromelain from pineapples. Microbial enzymes include fungal and bacterial proteases. Tenderization of meat can be achieved by keeping the rapidly chilled meat at 1 to 2 degrees Celsius to allow proteolysis by indigenous enzymes. For the preparation of pet food, minced meat or meat byproducts are hydrolyzed by protease to produce a liquid meat digester or a slurry with a much lower viscosity. Fish protein concentrates are generally prepared by treating ground fish parts with a protease. After hydrolysis, the bones and scales are removed by screening and the mixture of solubles and undigested fish solids is dried or separated by centrifugation. Enzymes can also be used for testing the quality and freshness of fish. Dear students, moving on to the next part, that is enzymes in starch conversion. Feedstocks containing starch include most of the cereal grains and tuberous crops such as potatoes. Starch contains about 15 to 30% amylose and 70 to 85% amylopectin. Enzymes have largely replaced the use of strong acid and high temperature to break down starchy materials. Three types of enzymes are involved in starch bioconversion: endoamylase, exoamylase, and debranching enzymes. Alpha amylase hydrolyzes internal alpha-1,4 glycosidic bonds of starch at random in an endo fashion, producing malto-oligosaccharides of varying chain lengths. It cannot act on alpha-1,6 linkages. Glucoamylase cleaves glucose units from the non-reducing end of starch, and it can hydrolyze both alpha-1,4 and alpha-1,6 linkage of starch. It is, however, slower in hydrolyzing alpha-1,6 linkages. Beta-amylase hydrolyzes the alpha-1,4 glycosidic bonds in starch from the non-reducing ends, generating maltose. The enzyme is unable to bypass the alpha-1,6 linkage and leaves dextrins, known as beta-limit dextrins. Pullulinase or isoamylase cleaves the alpha-1,6 linked branch points of starch and produces linear amylosaccharides of varying lengths. The dual function enzyme, that is amylopullulinase, hydrolyzes both alpha-1,4 and alpha-1,6 linkages of starch and generates DP2 and DP4. DP is degree of polymerization as products. The enzyme has potential for use in both liquefaction and saccharification of starch. Production of glucose syrup. D-glucose can readily be produced from starch by acid hydrolysis. However, this process has disadvantages, such as a low yield of glucose, formation of undesirable bitter sugar, and the inevitable formation of salt. With the discovery and development of thermostable alpha amylase from bacillus lycaeniformis, an enzymatic process has replaced the acid hydrolysis process. Enzymatic production of glucose from starch usually involves two essential and distinct steps. Number one is liquefaction, number second is saccharification. Efficiency of saccharification with glucoamylase can be improved by adding polyolanase or isoamylase. At high glucose concentrations, glucose molecules can polymerize in a reaction called reversion, forming unwanted byproducts such as maltose, isomaltose, and higher saccharides that decrease the glucose yield and purity. The polymerization reaction can be catalyzed by glucoamylase itself or by another enzyme called transglucosidase, which is often present in crude glucoamylase preparations. Typically, glucose syrup have 96% glucose, contain 2 to 3% disaccharides and 1 to 2% higher saccharides. Production of high fructose corn syrups. High fructose corn syrups are prepared by enzymatic isomerization of glucose syrups in column reactors containing immobilized enzyme. Reactors are run at pH 7.5 to 8 and 55 to 60 degrees Celsius. Mg double positive is usually added as a cofactor and stabilizer of the isomerase, and it also alleviates inhibition of the enzyme by Ca double positive. Immobilized glucose isomerase has a stability half-life of around 200 days in industrial practice. At equilibrium, the interconversion reaction of glucose and fructose modestly favors glucose over fructose at reactor temperatures 55 to 60 degrees Celsius. Therefore, at most glucose isomerase can produce high fructose corn syrups containing 42% fructose from glucose syrups. DNA technology has been used to introduce amino acid substitutions in glucose isomerase that enhance its thermal stability. Production of high maltose conversion syrups. Various maltose containing syrups are used in the brewing, baking, soft drink, canning, confectionery, and other food industries. There are three types of maltose containing syrups: high maltose syrup, extra high maltose syrup, and high conversion syrup. Production of these syrups from starch generally involves liquefaction and saccharification, as in the production of glucose. Depending on the maltose content of the syrup desired, saccharification is generally performed by using a maltogenic amylose such as beta amylase with polyolanase or isoamylase, or a fungal alpha amylase at pH 5 to 5.5 and 50 to 55 degrees Celsius. High conversion syrups are produced from liquefied starch by saccharification with a carefully balanced mixture of beta amylase or fungal alpha amylase and glucoamylase. After partial saccharification, the syrup is heated to destroy the enzyme action and prevent further glucose formation. Dear students, coming to next part, that's role of enzymes in beer and wine production. Beer brewing involves malting the barley in a malt house, followed by the preparation and fermentation of the wort in the brewery, while wine making requires the extraction of juice from grapes and subsequent fermentation of the juice by yeast. Beer brewing. This technology is based on the action of enzymes activated during malting and fermentation. Malting of barley depends on seed germination. which initiates the biosynthesis and activation of alpha and beta amylases, carboxypeptidases and beta glucanase that hydrolyze the seed reserve. All these enzymes should act in synergy under optimal conditions to produce high-quality malt. The commonly used beta glucanases are from Penicillium emulsioni, Aspergillus niger, Bacillus subtilis, and Trichoderma ricci. Wine production. This is a biotechnological process in which both yeast cells and enzymes play a key role. Three main exogenous enzymes used in wine production are pectinases, beta-glucanases, and hemicellulases. Recently, a fourth enzyme, that is beta-glucosidase, has attracted considerable attention in the wine industry because of its ability to improve the aroma of wines by modifying naturally present glucosylated precursors. The first microbial enzyme used in the wine industry was a commercial pectinase from Aspergillus, which contained varying amounts of pectin esterase, polygalactourinase, pectin lyase, and small amounts of hemicellulase. Addition of pectinase while crushing grapes or to the wine must improve juice extraction, reduces the clarification time, and increases the terpene content of wine. Also, pectinase preparations with high pectin lyase and low pectin methyl esterase activities are preferred to minimize the methanol released from methylated polygalactouric acid during wine production. Now, let us discuss enzymes involved in feed processing. Several enzymes like phytase, amylase, beta-glucanase, and xylanase are added to the cereal-based diets of such monogastrics to increase the utilization of dietary phosphorus, stearate, beta-glucanes, and arabinoxylanes respectively. It has been found that supplementing dairy, cow, and feedlot cattle diets with fiber-degraded enzymes has significant potential to improve feed utilization and animal performance. Ruminant feed enzyme additives, primarily xylanases and cellulases, are concentrated extracts resulting from bacterial or fungal fermentations that have specific enzymatic activities. Spraying enzymes onto feeds just before feeding provides increased management flexibility and bypasses any negative interactions that the ensiling process may have on silage enzyme performance. Protease enzymes may improve the digestion of cereal grains. Because starch digestion is partially a function of the protein starch matrix within the seed. Treating steam flaked sorghum with an enzyme mixture improved weight gain and feed efficiency in cereals by about 10%. Fiber degrading enzymes may also help to improve the digestion of cereal grains with fibrous seed coats. Cellulase, xylanase enzymes sprayed onto a barley and barley silage diet improved weight gain and feed efficiency in steers. With this, we come to the end of today's program. Hope you have enjoyed it well. Thank you for watching.